But what I found interesting when I did begin my work in history, and because of my interest in Orientalism and colonial and post-colonial studies, was that textbooks in English, American textbooks on history and world history, are exceptionally Eurocentric themselves, as we would understand. I mean, it's something that we're not surprised about. But what does seem to surprise me, at least, is that often not only do we find a disproportionate amount of material on Western history in world history textbooks, but also in the textbooks that are translated into Persian, into Farsi, we see this same degree of disproportion allocated to Western history. And even our own history is translated from English to Persian. And what is even more depressing is that the history of Southeast Asia we receive from Europe. The history of the Indian subcontinent we receive from Europe. The history of China we receive from Europe. And of course, this has implications. Because after all, Western history textbooks and Western texts in general, academic texts, are to a very large degree influenced by Orientalist discourse. And since the scholars here have already described what it means, Orientalist discourse, I won't go into great detail, but I just want to recall or remind you that Orientalism, it describes the various schools of thought or methods of investigation through which Europe, and now the United States as well, came to know the so-called East. And of course, the East is something very vague and non-existent in reality. So according to scholars like Seyyed, and I personally think that Seyyed himself is very much entrapped, or was very much entrapped in Orientalist discourse, but that of course is my personal opinion. People like him believe that it is through this discourse and the construction of knowledge through this discourse that the West has been able to dominate the rest of the world and to legitimize its hold of the so-called uncivilized other. And of course, some of the features of Orientalism is that the Orient is primitive, it's mysterious, it's exotic, it's incapable of self-government. You even see it in books, even very recent books about Iran, the Persian puzzle by Pollock, as if Iran is some sort of mystery, whereas for people who live in Iran, there's no mystery surrounding it. But for a very large public who reads such texts, this mystery seems to exist. So while the idea of representation is based upon a notion, often at least, that it is faithful to the original, often representation is interwoven with other issues as well. It's not simple truth. But then we have two problems here. One is that Orientalist representations of, let's say, Iran, of Muslims, of Asians, of Hindus, of the Chinese, of Africans, of West Africa, South Africa, because after all, Africa is not a monolithic entity, just as Asia isn't. And the same is true with Latin America, South America. One major problem that we face is, of course, that you have this stereotype, you often have a stereotypical Orientalist discourse. And it influences the way people in the West or the metropolis view the rest of the world. But what is even more dangerous is how often Orientalist discourse, because of its sheer power, is able to influence the way in which the so-called Orientals view themselves. In other words, a sort of split consciousness develops, as we call in Black studies, where a community of people views itself, an individual views himself or herself, as through the eyes of their community, their own people. But at the same time, they view themselves from the eyes of the European, the American, the metropolis, the center of power. How do they do that? They view it through literary texts, more importantly nowadays through film, through television, and through the news. Because after all, it is, we do not, if alternative news sources that from this, excluding those that come from within Iran, they don't come from China, they don't come from India, they don't come from Africa, they don't come from Latin America. They all come from the metropolis, the center of economic wealth and power, which is today the United States and Western Europe. So when this happens, we have what has previously been described as the, you know, the brown sahib, the house Negro, as has been called by Malcolm X, what Ala Ahmad calls Westruck, and or the Orientalized Oriental, which I personally like a great deal. But these are people who are very clearly Westernized in orientation and ideology and thought. People, for example, who see themselves as ideologically attached to the West. But what is even more interesting and more sophisticated is how Orientalist discourse influences us. Those of us who don't consider ourselves, we assume that we are somehow independent thinking, yet we are deeply influenced by Orientalist discourse. For example, and academia is very much influenced by culture. We do not live in a void, especially in the humanities. So when, for example, when we see television, it influences our perceptions of the world. That is why, for example, when you watch television, or for example, many journals, if you look in, on the streets of Tehran at these newspaper shops or whatever they're called, you'll see journals with pictures of young girls and boys whose hair color is blonde. Whereas in Iran, most people are not blonde. Eyes are blue. They're usually light colored, white. In other words, the standard of beauty becomes European. One could claim that this is because aesthetically Europeans are more attractive than people in the rest of the world. But one interesting example, when I was studying the history of the conquistadors, when they took the Americas, you know that the natives, or the so-called Indians, as the Europeans called them, they were effectively wiped out. When the conquistadors first went to Latin America, to the Americas, and of course the name America is a European term as well, it comes from the name of an Italian who so-called was part of the so-called discovery of the Americas, and the Americas, which had over 100 million people at that time, but the Europeans discovered it, whatever that means. When these Europeans went, the conquistadors went, in their memoirs, they wrote that the people of this region, the natives, they are extraordinarily beautiful and good-looking. Men and women, in general, that's how they saw it. Interestingly, I read a memoir or a piece from the other side, whereas one of the natives was writing to someone else or that the Europeans are extremely ugly and that they look like, excuse me, I'm just saying what he said, they look like dogs. And I wonder how anyone would ever be able to marry such a person. Now, the point is not that Europeans are inferior or Latin Americans are superior. That's not the point. The point is often when these two cultures first met and this immense imbalance of culture had not yet fully taken place, perceptions were different. Aesthetics obviously have essences. There are certain realities in essence. After all, that's my field of study. But the point is we're often influenced by culture, and culture is often influenced by power. Now, I want to cut it short. There are a few points I'd like to point out with regards to academia, because there are a few points that some of my colleagues here made. And that is, for example, in academia, we lag behind in the humanities. There are a couple of interesting points that you should take into account. One is that, first of all, the medium of academia is English. And we do not work on a level playing field. Because after all, none of us, our native language is English. Even if I feel somewhat fluent in English, it is not my native language. I've lived most of my life in Iran. Others are even, many of my colleagues are even more at a disadvantage. Secondly, the criteria in many academic journals are based upon Orientalist discourse, because many of the important journals in the humanities are Western. For example, one example, I once wrote an article which I called Constructing an Axis of Evil, Iran Memoirs in the, quote, Land of the Free, unquote. It was about Iranian memoirs that were published and written in the United States. I gave this to a very important journal, a very progressive so-called journal in the United States for publication. And in it, I analyzed these texts. And some of the elements that existed in these texts, I critiqued. One small example, in most of these texts, when it refers to the Iran-Iraq War, it said that, and this is what Azar Nafisi writes, this is what Satrapi writes, this is what most of them wrote, that the Iranian combatants in the war, they had these keys around their necks, these golden keys, that when they died, they were told that they would use them and go to heaven. Have you ever heard this before? It's extraordinary, but this is what Azar Nafisi says, this is what Satrapi says, this is what they all say in the soul of Iran, and all it's repeated in all of these texts. And I wrote in my article, in a small footnote, that this is one myth. And then when I submitted this to the journal, the whole paper, it was a long paper, the referee told me that you have to prove that there were no keys to heaven. You have to prove that there are no, how do you prove that there are no keys to heaven? I changed my paper a bit, and I said, look, I am a war veteran. I was in the war from early 1983 till the end of the war, on and off every year for a few months, as a volunteer. I was one of those people who you call, you know, who's supposed to have a keys to heaven. I never saw any keys to heaven. Of course, I put it academically. It was rejected. I told the editor of the journal that I'm withdrawing the paper, but if I was to claim that American soldiers in Iraq and in Afghanistan have keys to heaven, what would you say? Would you say, would you say that the opposite has to be disproved? Or would you just say this is irrational, this is foolish? No one would believe it. So if an Iranian is claimed in texts that are published in the United States, are bestsellers, that Iranians have keys to heaven, if someone says that Iranians have keys to heaven, it is acceptable, because irrational behavior, stupidity, ignorance is the sort of thing that we do. But if we say, or if someone says that Western soldiers, American soldiers have, it would be unacceptable, because obviously it runs against rationality. So, of course, I had this later, it was later published in the American Journal of Islamic Social Sciences, which is a good, credible journal, which belongs to Muslim academics in the United States. But the point is, and I've run out of time, the point is that even in academia, you have Orientalist discourse, and it changes the way we write. It forces us to work within those discursive practices. Otherwise, we are unable to publish. Thank you.